No doubt you will have seen footage of the devastating flooding in Spain a couple of weeks ago. According to the Spanish Meteorological Agency, Valencia received an entire year's worth of rain in just 8 hours. And that is simply a level of inundation that no government contingency plan anywhere in the world is currently capable of dealing with. And the tragic result in this case was the loss of more than 200 lives, not to mention billions of euros in property and infrastructure damage. According to climate scientists like Dr. Friederike Otto from Imperial College London, this kind of extraordinary flash flooding can now be very firmly connected to our rapidly warming atmosphere. As I'm sure you well-informed folks are already aware, for every degree Celsius of warming, our planet's atmosphere retains about 7% more moisture. We're currently about 1.4 degrees Celsius warmer than pre-industrial times now, so you can do the arithmetic for yourself. And that additional water doesn't spread itself neatly around the planet so that all each of us has to do is simply buy a slightly more robust umbrella. Now, it clumps together with increasingly extreme regional weather systems, resulting in the catastrophic scenes we've just witnessed in Spain and in so many other parts of the world in recent years. Now, you might think this is just one more disaster in a long litany of relentless bad news when it comes to the climate emergency, and you might be wondering whether we're ever going to hear about any positive stuff that might actually be happening to address the problem. Those positive initiatives are in quite short supply at the moment, quite frankly, which is why a recent piece of research published by the European Environment Agency represents a rare ray of sunshine in an otherwise fairly gloomy outlook. Hello, and welcome to Just Have a Think. Now, I wouldn't want any of you regular viewers to get the idea that I'd suddenly been carried off on a cloud of delusional optimism, heaven forfends. But when I read that greenhouse gas emissions in European Union nations actually fell by 8% in 2023, I thought that was something we should take a quick look at, because with the notable exception of the COVID lockdown period, that level of emissions reduction has simply never happened in any major region anywhere on the planet. The new report tells us that EU greenhouse gas emissions are now 37% below 1990 levels. So what's going on then? Well, the biggest move is, of course, the accelerating shutdown of coal-fired power plants across the continent. Now, if the UK was still part of the EU, I'd have been able to celebrate the fact that my country was the first developed nation to completely do away with coal for energy when we closed our last coal-fired power station earlier this year. But the UK is no longer part of the EU, is it? So that milestone doesn't play any part in this new report. Now, our continental European cousins have been making more and more of their own electricity from renewables like wind and solar, and that transition is finally starting to show up in a meaningful way in statistical data. The European Commission described the reduction as very encouraging and said it reinforced confidence in the EU's ability to meet its target of cutting emissions by 55% by 2030. But the positivity varies significantly from sector to sector. Energy supply made up 27% of emissions in 2022, but those emissions represent a reduction of 43% from 1990 levels. That's the best performance of any sector, led by huge developments in renewables. By contrast, the domestic transport sector is still a bit of a basket case. Emissions in this sector are still substantially higher than they were in 1990. Recent years have seen faster reductions, partly thanks to the statistical anomaly that was COVID, and also due to the uptake in electric vehicles. But that uptake has really been quite disappointing so far. There's really no other way to describe it. EV sales nearly doubled from 2021 to 2022, but then only increased by a measly 1 percentage point in 2023. Electric vehicles represented less than a quarter of all new car sales last year, and pure battery electric cars are still only 1.7% of the existing EU car fleet. European car makers are currently acting like rabbits in the headlights of a large approaching juggernaut called China. And the European Commission isn't providing the right mechanisms and incentives to enable the industry to get its act together. So like it or not, if it stays the way it is, then cheaper and better quality Chinese electric vehicles will arrive like a tsunami, and the European car industry will be in very serious jeopardy indeed. In fact, that's a message that might sound very familiar to viewers across the pond in the States as well, and in places like Australia. I know it sounds a bit fatalistic and everything, but time and time again through modern history, incumbent companies and industries have been caught out by their own short-sighted complacency. And it looks for all the world like that's exactly what's happening again here. On a slightly more positive note, EU industry has been making consistent progress throughout the 32-year period of the study, with an overall 42% decline in emissions, largely as a result of improved energy efficiency measures. The good news is there's still loads of scope to further decarbonise big chunks of this sector with things like industrial heat pumps, thermal storage solutions, and greater electrification of many industrial processes. Energy efficiency also drove a 35% reduction in emissions from buildings, despite the fact that more homes were being built during the period and those homes tended to be larger. Simple measures like improved insulation and a move towards less carbon-intensive fuels, or better still, towards full electrification through hugely more efficient technologies like heat pumps, will continue to push building emissions down towards zero in the coming years. Then there's agriculture and land use, both of which have performed significantly below the average. Methane emissions from ruminant livestock like cows and sheep are a biggie, of course, as we saw in a recent video on this channel. And the agricultural industry is still struggling to get to grips with this thorny issue. Agricultural emissions are down 24% overall though, so it's not a complete catastrophe, but there's no doubt that a lot more focus needs to be put into this sector, as it does on overall land use. The land acts as a carbon sink, which is why this number is a negative number. But although there were some improvements in the early 90s, those have all been wiped out in more recent years, and the capacity of the land to capture carbon is now no better than it was 32 years ago, which is an extremely worrying trend indeed. It can be turned around, of course, but it'll take a massive reduction in net deforestation levels, as well as technological interventions to improve harvesting efficiencies and perhaps even reduced agricultural land use as a result of more plant-based diets, precision fermentation, and cellular agriculture. But that's a whole other topic that we've covered in previous videos. Performances do vary from member state to member state as well, of course. Green triangles on this chart represent above 2030 trajectory performances in areas like share of renewables, primary and final energy consumption, and overall greenhouse gas emissions. The Baltic and Nordic states, Scandinavia, Portugal, Czechia and Greece, all get top marks, with others doing less well, and Ireland lagging behind in every category as shown by the amber triangles. The results of those efforts are represented on this chart. The horizontal axis shows the change in net emissions of each country since 1990, from no change over here to 100% reduction over here. Then up the vertical axis, we've got the change in gross emissions during the same period. Sweden wins top prize here, achieving net reductions of more than 80%, followed by Romania, Lithuania, and Estonia. There's a whole gaggle of nations sitting in the middle, just as you'd expect from any normal distribution model. And then we've got the naughty step up here with countries like Spain, Austria, Slovenia and Ireland. And what the heck are you guys doing in Cyprus? So although the headline number of an 8% reduction last year and a 37% overall reduction across the EU since 1990 is encouraging on the face of it, there's obviously a lot more work still to do to bring every nation and sector in line to get the whole block across the 55% emission reduction target by 2030 and keep it on a path to net zero by 2050. The report's authors point out that the current policies from member states are expected to reduce emissions by 43% by 2030 compared to 1990 levels. Planned measures that are yet to be enacted would push that up to 49%, but that's still 6 percentage points short of the 2030 target, isn't it? And of course, underscoring the whole report are events like those we looked at in Spain right at the start of the video. As the EEA tells us, we're now witnessing everything from unseasonable heat waves to extended droughts, unusually warm seas, and unprecedented flooding and major storms. Climate change continues to progress rapidly, they remind us, with recent observations indicating accelerating warming. In some regions, climate change is advancing much faster, while feedback loops and non-linear developments can further accelerate these shifts, increasing associated risks. But advances in low carbon technologies are also non-linear. The only thing standing in our way is us, or perhaps more accurately, the policymakers who govern us. Anyway, no doubt you've got your own views on the subject, so as always, the place to leave your thoughts is in the comment section below. That's it for this week though. Thanks as always to the amazing folks who support my work via Patreon and who enable me to keep ads and sponsorship messages out of your way. And an extra special thank you to the folks whose names are scrolling up the screen beside me here, all of whom celebrate an anniversary of Patreon support in November. Don't forget to jump over to patreon.com/justhaveathink to find out how you can join them and have a look at all the exclusive perks you can get there. And if you enjoyed this video, then you can really hugely support me by hitting the subscribe button on YouTube to help us get to our next channel milestone of 600,000 subscribers. Won't cost you a penny to do that, and it's just a simple click away. either down there somewhere or on that icon there. As always, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.